Well, so welcome everyone. So it's really a pleasure to introduce our speaker, Professor Shakuntala Chatterjee, today from S.N. Bose National Center for Basic Sciences in Calcutta. Shakuntala is an alumni of DTP, and for many here, she of course doesn't need an introduction. But Shakuntala worked with Mustansir as a PhD student, and afterwards she went to Jülich to work with Günter Schütz, and later to Technion to work with Yariv Kafri before joining SNB-NCBS as a permanent faculty. Shakuntala broadly works in the area of statistical physics, specifically out of equilibrium systems, phase ordering kinetics, exact solution using Bethe-Ansatz, and also on problems at the interface of physics and biology. And she has done recently very interesting works related to this nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics that relates to the theory of Herbert Spohn. So something that she's going to talk about today. So without further delay, I request Shakuntala to please begin her seminar.
Okay, thanks, Judith, for the kind introduction. And also I thank both you and Rishi for the kind invitation to speak here. The title of my talk is Dynamics of Coupled Modes for Sliding Particles on a Fluctuating Landscape. Before I start talking about this work, let me just spend one slide on the other research activities that is going on in my group. So my group at S.N. Bose Center is focused on non-equilibrium statistical physics and biological systems. I have an active research interest in the problem of bacterial chemotaxis, where we consider some bacteria which show a tendency to migrate towards a region where there is more food. And we are interested in this motion, and particularly we ask the question how this chemotactic performance is affected by the fluctuations which are present inside the cell. So inside the cell, there are lots of reactions which are taking place. Some protein levels are going up, some are going down. We are asking how this noise affects the chemotactic performance of E. coli bacteria. And for this project, I have collaborated with my ex-student Shubrata Dev, who was a grad student at S.N. Bose Center. Right now, he's doing a postdoc at Indra Paris. And also Shobhan Dev Bondol is the current PhD student who is working on this project. My group is also interested in dynamics of biofilaments, where we consider essentially there are some filaments in the inside a cell called actins. And when they're growing, they put some force on the cell membrane and cause membrane deformation. And this is an important process in cell motility. So we are interested in this force generation mechanism, how the interaction between the filaments and the membrane, etc. And my former student Rajkumar Sadhu had worked on this problem, and right now he's doing a postdoc at Weizmann Institute in Israel. I'm also interested off and on the system of periodic drive in presence of many particles. So we ask the question, if we have many particles which have some kind of interactions among themselves, and we drive the system periodically, then what happens to it? Particularly, we are interested how the current in the system, how does it behave? And for this project, I have been collaborating with Punnabrata Pradhan, who is my colleague at S.N. Bose Center and also an ex-student of this department, DTP. And our joint student Deepshikha Dash is working on it right now. And Rakesh and Shubhashish are earlier people with whom we had interacted. Rakesh is now a postdoc at Tel Aviv University. And Shubhashish was a postdoc in our group. Now he has moved to Texas from here. So the problem that I wanted to talk about today was done in collaboration with Shouri Chakraborty, who was another PhD student of mine. And right now she's doing a postdoc at University of Saarland in Germany. And we have also collaborated with Mustansir for this. And this work is not terribly new. It's kind of, we have done it a couple of years back, but I chose this topic for today's talk because Tridib was particularly interested to know more about it. Okay, so this is the field of nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics. And this has recently developed a lot of research interest. So here in this system, people considered non-equilibrium systems which have multiple conserved fields whose time evolutions are coupled to each other. And within the formalism of NLFH, people show that these modes move ballistically, I mean, this coupling and the conservation that gives rise to some slow modes in the system, which decay very slowly in the long time limit, and such that these modes essentially govern the large scale properties of the system. And in particular, the modes show a power law decay, and by characterizing this decay along with the power law exponent, people have been able to identify certain dynamical universality classes for this system, and that actually depends on the mode coupling. I will explain everything, all these things, what I mean in detail shortly. Now, before NLFH was used, people were mainly familiar with two universality classes, diffusive and KPZ universality classes. But after NLFH, people started discovering certain unconventional universality classes like five-third Levy, three-half Levy, golden mean, etc. I will describe this, what I mean by these universality classes shortly. And in a particularly interesting development, Popkov et al. Had shown in 2015, this paper was published in PNAS, that the dynamical exponent, the exponent that, that describes the power law decay of the slow modes with time, the dynamical exponents can be expressed as the Kepler ratio of successive numbers of the Fibonacci sequence. This was a particularly striking result. These are some of the references, and by no means they are exhaustive. But just one point I wanted to make is, long time back in 2001, for the first time, the dynamics of coupled conserved modes were studied by these people, and this study actually had happened in TIFR. And however, the main interest started since Van Buren wrote an article in 2012, and since then there had been a lot of research activities in this field, but there are many other important papers which I have just, I could not.
Shakuntala?
Yes.
My understanding of Van Buren's work was that he is completely agnostic about whether we're talking classically or quantum mechanically, right? He doesn't care. The whole idea is supposed to go through independently of that, right? Am I correct?
Yes.
Okay, so these universality classes don't care whether the microscopic dynamics is classical or quantum.
Kedar, I cannot hear you very well. I think.
I'm sorry, I'll speak up. I'm just asking, this classification into universality classes doesn't care whether the dynamics is classical or quantum, right?
Sorry, classification Shakuntala, of universality classes, after that, what did you say?
Does not depend on whether the dynamics is classical or quantum. Does it require the dynamic for the universality classes, whether it's for quantum dynamics or classical, is immaterial to it, to that. Is that, oh, I believe,
so
that's all,
so most of the papers that I am familiar with, it deals with classical systems.
I was wondering about the Van Buren work. I was just trying to understand that, since you're reviewing. The Van Buren work makes a very general argument, right?
Yes. Van Buren work makes a very general argument. Okay. I get the question now. But it was actually Schoen who had formulated it in the subsequent studies for the field of non-equilibrium statistical physics. Okay, so let me share my screen once more. So what I wanted to do in today's talk, I wanted to use this formalism of NLFH in the system that I am interested in. This is a system of coupled system of particles on a one-dimensional energy landscape. So I have a set of particles which move on an energy landscape. So they want to go towards region where there is less energy, and they also have the ability to modify the shape of the energy landscape around their position. Now, these type of systems are not completely abstract. There are certain physical processes which actually show this type of behavior. For example, in movement of certain membrane proteins. So on our cell membrane, there are certain proteins which move along the membrane, and these proteins prefer a certain type of a membrane curvature. some of these proteins, for example, would like to prefer that part of the membrane which is, let's say, convex. And these proteins also have the ability to modify the shape of the membrane around their position such that the membrane assumes a convex shape. So this is one example that the kind of model that we are talking about might be useful. Although the model actually that we are studying is much simpler than that, we don't claim that we are modeling cell membrane or membrane protein structure, etc. Now in our model, there are two concept fields. One is the particle density. The particles move on the landscape, but they do not get created or annihilated. So the local density of the particles remain conserved. And I will show that the landscape dynamics is such that the local height gradient of the landscape is also conserved. So I have two conserved fields whose time evolutions are coupled to each other. And as I vary the two-way coupling parameters, we get an interesting phase diagram which consists of non-equilibrium ordered and disordered phases. In this talk, I will mainly focus on the disordered phase, particularly the dynamics of the system in the disordered phase. And I want to use the formalism of nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics or NLFH to study these dynamics. But there is one problem here. So far, in all the systems where NLFH had been studied, the exact expression of current as a function of density was known. And that knowledge is actually needed in order to use this NLFH, because as I will show that you need to find the derivative of current with respect to densities at various stages. So we need to know how current depends on density. But in our system, in the disordered phase, although there is no long-ranged order, but it is still not a product measure state. Like there are still short-ranged correlations present. Everything doesn't factorize. And these short-ranged correlations form, we do not know. So therefore, we don't know how to write down an exact expression for current. So we use some approximate expression and we check our predictions against numerical simulations. And when we do that, we discover an extremely interesting thing that this system shows very important finite size effects. And it is not only true for our system, we will argue that it is true in this finite size effects are present in this very structure of this NLFH formalism. So I will describe that. And we find some rich dynamics apart from diffusive and KPZ universality classes, which people were already familiar with. We have found new universality classes like modified KPZ or 5/3 Levy in our system. I will also show that the NLFH predicts that our system should also support golden mean and 3/2 Levy, these two universality classes, but they are masked by finite size effects and we cannot see them. So this is the plan of my talk. First, I will give a brief overview of NLFH in one dimension. Then I will describe my model. I will briefly describe the ordered and disordered phases, and then I will focus mainly on the dynamics in the disordered phase. So here is a brief overview of NLFH. Consider a system. It has n conserved quantities. So rho lambda xt is the corresponding densities, and lambda can go from 1 to n. And let j lambda xt be the locally conserved current. And here I have written down the continuity equation for each component. And I have written in a compact form, I have defined these variable vectors, rho vector and j vector. Clearly, these are n component vectors whose components are rho 1, rho 2, or j1, j2, etc. Now, when I say the time evolution of these conserved fields are coupled, I mean that j lambda does not depend on rho lambda alone. In principle, it can depend on all rho 1, rho 2 up to rho n. Next, I assume that the space-time dependence of this current happens only through its dependence on locally conserved densities. So j depends on x and t only via its dependence on rho xt. So as soon as I say that, immediately I can write jx rho, del x j in this form. Here j bar is the current Jacobian with the matrix elements del j lambda del rho mu. So you see, this is one example where I need to differentiate current with respect to density. And therefore, I really need this functional nature of dependence.
So Shakuntala, one thing I'm never been clear on is whether you only need to know the some course which is this functional dependence or the exact function matters.
No, Kedar, I don't hear what you are saying. Can somebody please repeat?
Sorry, I just mean, do you need every detail of this functional dependence or only the behavior at a small row or something like that? Sorry, how universal is this?
Should Kedar, can you speak a little bit slowly? Your voice
I can rephrase if it is. Should I rephrase? What,
Yeah.
Not rephrase, but reiterate, sorry. So I think Kedar is asking that does the precise dependence of the function J on rho matters, or does only certain leading order term in the expansion of this function J on rho that is sufficient for this universality classes?
I will come to it, Kedar. As I will show that actually the quadratic nonlinearities we need to take into account in order to decide the dynamical universality classes. Just wait, I will just come to it in the next slide itself.
And Shakuntala, okay. Are you using certain local equilibrium assumption already? Yeah, later.
Sorry?
Okay. Are you already using certain local equilibrium assumption?
Yeah, local equilibrium comes because I am saying that the current is not a function of x and t explicitly. It is depending on x and t via its dependence on rho.
Okay.
There I am assuming local equilibrium. But I think Kedar is asking whether the dependence, exact dependence matters or to that. So my answer to that was to the linear order and to the quadratic order, the dependence I should have to take into account in order to decide the universality class. But I will just explain that in the next slide.
Yeah.
Okay. So, so first let me expand the density around their average value. So let me write rho lambda xt as rho lambda plus some small perturbation u lambda xt. And first let me keep terms, only linear terms in u lambda. And then I get a system of coupled linear partial differential equations. And I know that by diagonalizing this Jacobian matrix, I can decouple these equations. And then I get the normal modes. So normal modes are just some linear transformation of u. And the time evolution equation for these normal modes are del t phi alpha is v alpha del x phi alpha, where v alpha is the eigenvalue. I think this is clear. Now notice that this equation has the traveling wave form. I mean, it is a wave equation, therefore the normal mode satisfy traveling wave solution. So phi alpha is a function of x minus v alpha t. Now, coming to Kedar's question, let me not stop at the linear level. Let me expand the current around the stationary densities, but retain quadratic nonlinearities. Clearly, at the quadratic level, now these normal modes will be coupled again, right? So now the time evolution equation has this form. The first term is the term that is coming from linear theory, which was already there. The second term is what Kedar was asking about. Here, the quadratic nonlinearities are coming into play. Here, G alpha is the mode coupling matrix. And you can easily show that there are a few steps of algebra involved here, but it is quite straightforward that this matrix G alpha is actually depends on the Hessian. Just one second. Let me hide this. Yeah, this depends on the Hessian that is the second derivative of current with respect to density. And this R is the same matrix, this matrix that transforms U to phi. So therefore, if I know the current, I can differentiate it and calculate this Hessian. And from there, I can construct this mode coupling matrices. And there are two additional terms that I have written down. These are two phenomenological terms that I have put in by hand. One is the diffusive term, another is just the noise term. So these are phenomenological at this level, I've just put them by hand. Now I am interested in this dynamical structure function, which is the correlation between phi alpha xt and phi alpha 0,0. And I call it s alpha xt. And I already know from linear theory that these fluctuations are peaked around x alpha t, which is x alpha 0 minus v alpha t. That is, this structure function should be peaked and the peak should move through the system with a speed v alpha. And I also make an assumption at this point that the width of that peak grows with time sub-ballistically. Okay, why sub-ballistic? I will just right now it's an assumption, but I will show later on that it is a self-consistent one. So then I use the following scaling answers, that S alpha XT has the following scaling form. Here F alpha is a scaling function. The scaling variable is X minus V alpha T divided by T to the 1 over Z alpha. Here Z alpha is the dynamical exponent. It tells you how the peak, how the fluctuations are dissipating in the system, how fast with time. And this prefactor, T to the minus 1 over Z alpha, it tells you how quickly with time the peak of the fluctuation, the peak height is dissipating. Next, we do a Fourier transform in space and a Laplace transform in time. That gives me this function S alpha tilde. And instead of writing it as a function of k and omega, the Fourier and Laplace variable, I make a transformation. I define a new variable zeta alpha, which is omega alpha tilde times k to the minus z alpha. Even if you forget the notation, it's okay. It's not so important at this stage. So finally, this is
Shakuntala, yes. Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Yeah, can you go back to the previous slide, please?
Yeah, just 1 second. Yeah.
So here there's an assumption that the linear part of the current in rho is the dominant one. And the quadratic part is in some way subdominant because, you know, basically the dominant motion you were saying is the ballistic one. And then there is some sort of small correction to it.
So
what is the parameter which says that the linear thing is dependent and this quadratic is subdominant? Is there some some parameter?
This z alpha is the dynamical exponent, and this takes the value, this dynamical exponent should be larger than one. That makes sure that the peak, the width of this fluctuation is dissipating with time, but with a rate which is smaller than ballistic.
So the dynamical exponent. If I make a Taylor expansion of J in rho, so J is something rho plus something rho square. So some small parameter appears in front of rho square. Is that right or what? See, the point is that it's a quadratic function, right? And that's somehow you're saying that the linear part is the dominant one clearly because it's...
This U lambda that we have here, no? We are expanding the density about its global average, and this is a small perturbation. This U lambda is small, actually.
Yeah, small so in what? Small in what? Is there some parameter which says that U lambda is small?
I am neglecting the cubic terms and higher order terms in U.
Is there some parameter which says that? I mean, you know, like, is it like h bar or is it like some 1 upon n? Or is it, I mean, what tells me that, no, also this is not like, okay, maybe this is.
No, Gautam, that this, using here hydrodynamic expansion, right? So I am using the fact that rho lambda is a slowly varying function of x.
Slowly varying function of x. I see. So this is some kind of derivative. This is some kind of derivative expansion. Is that right?
Yeah. It is. I mean, it is because if I want to use it in as I will show you that we are mainly making this expansion in the disordered phase where we do not expect. We expect densities to be mostly flat. There are some small fluctuations, but if you want to use it in the case in the part of the phase diagram where you actually do have strong density variation. For example, you have a case of phase separation. Okay, so there is, so in those cases, you will actually see this kind of expansion actually breaks down. In fact, this eigenvalue actually becomes non-real. It picks up an imaginary component, therefore the linear instability grows. So there, this hydrodynamic expansion fails actually.
I see.
Okay. So here, okay.
So Kunchalati, I had one question. So, so these theories are defined at a hydrodynamic scale, right? So there is a coarse graining length scale on top of which it is defined. So is it the smallness that Gautam is referring? Could that coarse grained length scale or time scale could play the role of small parameter?
You are saying that whether in the coarse graining length scale, whether the dependence is slow enough. That is what
right. So when you define a hydrodynamic theory, you have a microscopic dynamics and scales, and you are defining it above a certain coarse graining length scale.
That's
where you
right.
integrate, and this gives you a scale where it defines your slowness.
That is absolutely right. Yeah.
Right. So all the higher order terms in the perturbation expansion, they are in smaller in this coarse grain length scales.
Right.
Yeah. I have one more question, related questions to what Gautam was asking. So in your dynamical exponent Z, could that also be exactly equal to one, or is there some restrictions which says?
No, we are using right now, it is an assumption. We are saying that it grows sub-ballistically, but I will show that this is a self-consistent assumption. It is strictly larger than one. I can show that.
Okay. So it's always the spread has to be, so there's of course a shift that's happening, but the spread is always smaller or slower than
the ballistic, sub-ballistic. That's right. Yeah.
Okay. And the coefficients D and B that you added phenomenologically,
yeah,
do they also depend on your field phi or rho, or they are constant in your assumption?
D and B, I think these were constant, but when I'm actually making this, I mean, B tilde, D tilde, they actually involve this transformation R.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
So this is where I was. So this is the final form of the scaling structure, dynamical structure function that I have. So then we use these answers to solve the mode coupling equation. And that gives me, I write it in this form. I write it as k to the minus z alpha times some other function h alpha zeta alpha. After writing it in this form, I plug it back in the mode coupling equation, and that gives me some condition on this scaling function, the unknown function h alpha that I have written here. So this is that condition, and this is the most important equation which we will analyze. So here you see that this function is given by this. There are a few things that I want to mention here. D alpha is again the same diffusive term that I had introduced earlier. And Q alpha beta, these are new notations that I have introduced. These are proportional to G alpha beta beta square. What is G alpha beta beta? Just to remind you, it tells me how the time evolution of mode alpha is coupled by mode, is affected by presence of mode beta. So if G alpha beta beta is zero, that means mode beta does not affect the time evolution of mode alpha. And Q alpha beta is proportional to the square of this matrix element. And Q alpha alpha is similarly, it tells you the self coupling of mode alpha at the quadratic level. There is another point here, that you see that I have taken the k goes to zero limit, and all these terms, these last terms, they contain power of k. However, the k goes to zero, in the k goes to zero limit, I can get a non-trivial scaling solution if and only if this at least one of these terms survive. Because otherwise, if all of them become zero, then that means that h alpha zeta alpha just becomes 1 over zeta alpha. And you can put it back in this equation, and you can show that that just gives you the linear theory back. So then the solution is like you have a fluctuation. It keeps going through the system ballistically with no dissipation. Now, we know that that is not physical, because we see from the equation that modes are coupled. We have by hand put in diffusion and noise, etc. So there will be fluctuations and there will be dissipation. So therefore, we are only looking for, I mean, we get a non-trivial scaling limit only in the case when at least one of these terms survive. Now, let me assume for the simplest possible case, let's say Q alpha beta and Q alpha alpha, both are zero. Physically, that means mode alpha is completely isolated from all the other modes. Then I have only this first term and this diffusive term in the scaling function. So the scaling function now looks like this. Here you see.
Could you go back to the previous slide, please? Yeah, so I'm just confused at how the 1 over H alpha expansion that you've written, is it an assumption or it is...
This was a scaling ansatz, right? You put these ansatz back in the mode coupling equation. Okay, and you try to solve that equation using these ansatz. That gives you this condition on H alpha zeta alpha.
Okay. And there to get this H alpha zeta alpha, you need to put this k tending to zero limit.
Yes.
Okay.
So I did not show that derivation here. It's a long derivation, and this is just an overview anyway. I wanted to. So in the case when both the self coupling and cross coupling term vanishes, then my scaling function looks like this. Now here you see, if I choose z alpha is equal to 2. Then this exponent becomes zero. And actually, this term survives in the k goes to zero limit. I have a non-trivial k goes to zero limit. This is the case of a diffusive mode. And you can actually solve for the scaling function in this case. And you can show that the scaling function has this form. So you can see it is a Gaussian with a moving peak whose width is diffusively spreading with time. This is the diffusive universality class. Now let me consider the other case when, let's say the self-coupling term is still zero, but there is at least some beta for which the cross-coupling term is non-zero. Then my scaling function looks like this. And here you notice that here the exponent is 2 minus z alpha, and here the exponent is 1 plus z beta minus z alpha. Now, I started with the assumption that all dynamical exponents are larger than 1, which means 1 plus 1 over z beta is less than 2. So therefore, the decay of this mode is slower than the decay of this mode. So in the k goes to 0 limit, definitely these modes will dominate. There are multiple summation involved here. I mean, there are many terms in the summation. Which beta will dominate? The beta for which z beta is maximum. Okay. So for that mode, I get z alpha is equal to 1 plus 1 over z beta max. And you see, it is greater than 1. So therefore, it is consistent, the what I said earlier, that all the dynamical exponents are greater than 1. Indeed, I find that this is greater than 1. So what I have proven so far is in the case when the self-coupling vanishes, I have two possibilities. Either z alpha is 2, diffusive mode, or z alpha is less than 2. And I find that this satisfies this inequality. Next, I will show that even when the self-coupling term is non-zero, the same inequality is satisfied. So imagine first that this is not true. Imagine that when self-coupling is non-zero, there exists some beta star for which you get a dynamical exponent which is larger than 2 for some special mode beta star. Then, let me go back to this form. Then in order to have a non-trivial scaling limit, as I said earlier, at least one of these terms should dominate the k goes to zero mode. So now let's say if the diffusive term dominates, then I have z is z alpha is equal to 2. If the self-coupling term is surviving, then I have z alpha is 3/2. And if one of the cross-coupling term is surviving, then I have z alpha is 1 plus 1 over z beta star. Z beta star is the one for which I had assumed that it is greater than 2. So what are the possibilities? Z alpha is 2, z alpha is 3/2, and in this case, z alpha takes a value which is less than 3/2. So which excludes the possibility that z alpha is greater than 2. So therefore, I have proved that even in the case when self-coupling is non-vanishing, this inequality satisfies for all the modes. Now, there is one question still left. What is the value of z alpha in this case? I had given you these three options. Here I use the other criteria that none of the scaling limit, it should not diverge, because if one of these exponents become negative then that diverges in the k goes to zero limit. That I don't expect, because I expect the fluctuations should decay with time. So z alpha is equal to 3 half is the only possible choice for that. This is the KPZ universality class. Now next I will show that there are two possible scaling functions which two families of scaling functions which are possible. One is the usual KPZ scaling. This happens when all the z beta, that is all the beta modes with which the alpha mode is coupled to, their dynamical exponent is strictly less than 2. Then the cross coupling term does not survive in the k goes to 0 limit, and I have this form of the scaling. This is the usual KPZ scaling, and it is known that this function is given by Prohofer-Spohn scaling function. Its form is known. However, there is another possibility that one of the modes to which the alpha mode is coupled to is diffusive. Then you have this 1 plus 1 over 2 minus 3 half, which is again 0. So this term also survives the k goes to 0 limit, and then the scaling solution, the scaling function also has contribution from the cross-coupling terms. And that is called a modified KPZ scaling. So it is the same dynamical exponent, but a slightly different scaling function. So this concludes my overview on the NLFH part. Next, I will use this NLFH part in my model. So first, let me describe my model.
So when you talk about this Prohofer-Spohn scaling form, does it mean that the scaling functions satisfy the KPZ equation?
The scaling function if you write down the scaling relationship for the height fluctuation, then you the scaling function that comes, that scaling function is given by the Prohofer-Spohn scaling function.
So with this Prohofer-Spohn scaling function for a KPZ height, is that so?
Yes.
So does it mean that one of your normal modes, or probably the structure factor, does it satisfy directly the KPZ equation? Could you see that?
KPZ universality class, it would satisfy, but whether it satisfies the KPZ equation directly, for example, in my system, I did not see that.
Shakur, can I just to add, I'm very anti-amity, but apart from knowing that the value is one third for the experiment, what is Spohn's theory tells you that the scaling function satisfies the scaling form? Can you plug this back in and derive an equation, which is the KPZ equation? I think that's what Tilly was asking.
I could not hear the question. You said that I could not hear what you said.
I guess this is what I asked. Kedar asking the similar direction that Spohn's work also finds this KPZ scaling, right? So he's asking, is this, do you see these KPZ equation emerging rather than just the scaling function?
Yeah, what I know that we see for this, we see this scaling function emerges, and it is the Prohofer-Spohn scaling function. But I don't know if it also satisfies the KPZ KPZ equation that exactly. This I don't know. I think that it is only for the scaling function. Okay, so I don't know if it also satisfies the KPZ scale equation directly. Yeah.
I have one more question. So in the Herbert's theory, they had this three conserved fields, and one of them is a heat mode, and the two go that leads, which is this traveling mode, which gives this either KPZ. So in your system, it seems so far in your theory, all modes you are treating them equally. Did I understand correctly?
I only have two modes in my system.
So you have only two modes. There is no stationary modes or no heat.
No, in my model, I have only two conserved quantities, the particle density and the local height gradient.
Right.
And I have only two modes in the system.
But in your theory, which you presented, is there a stationary mode that you could see? Where would that come from?
So, Station, you are asking if there is some V alpha, some eigenvalue where it is possible to have zero value. I think it is possible. Yeah, it doesn't rule. We are not ruling it out that it the peak here the V alpha is zero. That is possible. I think I never assumed that. What I assumed here, by the way, that all the V alpha should be distinct. All the modes should move with different speeds. But whether they are at least one of them can be zero, I think it is possible. Yeah.
If you could correct me, but this is what in the theory of Herbert-Spohn define one heat peak, right? Which is always non-moving heat peak. And two sound
peaks. Definitely I don't need to have one non-moving thing. And as I will show you in the model that I have used, I have only two modes and they are always moving. That is what I had seen.
Okay.
So, yeah. So the model that I'm looking at, it is defined on a one-dimensional lattice. Each site is occupied by either an H particle or an L particle. For an H particle, I use a filled circle. For an L particle, I use an empty circle. And each bond of the lattice can have two possible orientations, plus or minus pi over 4. So therefore, a typical configuration looks like this. And as you can see from here, that when I arrange the bonds with these two possible orientations, I actually generate something that looks like a landscape, something that looks like a height profile. And these particles are moving on that height profile, and this is the dynamical rules. So H particles, I call them heavy particles, and L stands for light. So they preferentially displace the L particles while sliding downhill. So here, if, for example, here, there is an H particle, a downslope bond, and an L particle. These two particles interchange position with a D plus A, and the reverse process happens with a D minus A. Similarly, if there is an upslope bond and a downslope bond with the H particle sitting in the intervening site, then these two bonds interchange position with a E plus B, and the reverse process happens with a E minus B. Instead of an H, if I had an L here, then the processes happen with rate E minus B prime and E plus B prime respectively. So you see, first of all, two things. One is the particles are just interchanging position. They're not getting created or annihilated. So the density of H or L particles, that is conserved. And I remember, although I'm saying it like this, L particle, H particle, I don't have any hole in my system. Okay. So you can also think of them as particle and hole. Although I will use the language H and L particles in my talk. And also the upslope and downslope bonds also, they just interchange position. So there is no creation or annihilation of bond orientation also. So therefore, the total number of upslope bonds, that is also another quantity that is conserved. And so therefore, I have two conserved quantities whose time evolutions are coupled. If I vary these two coupling parameters, B and B prime, this is the phase diagram that I get. Here, these are all ordered phases and these various types of ordering. And this dotted part is the disordered phase. I will mainly focus on the disordered phase, but I will briefly just tell you what is the nature of the ordered phases. And this was actually, we had studied, this was also part of Shori's thesis work. And we had made a detailed study of all these ordered phases sometime back. But I am not going to talk about them in detail today. So these are the different ordered phases. So here, when both B and B prime are positive, then I have SPS, which is called strong phase separation. So here is a typical configuration looks like. All the downslope bonds are aligned together. All the upslope bonds are aligned together such that the landscape gives rise to a deep valley. And this red part shows the position of the H particles. All the H particles are present at the bottom of the valley, and all the L particles are present at the upper portion. I have periodic boundary condition in my system. So a valley here means there is a hill here at this end. Okay. So all the L particles are present at the top of the hill. All the H particles are present at the bottom of the valley. This is a strong phase separation. This is the highest possible order present in the system. all downslope bonds together, all upslope bonds together, all H particles together, all L particles together. This is the highest possible order. On this dotted line, I have IPS phase, which is the infinite, and it's called infinitesimal current with phase separation. Here, this is how a typical configuration looks. I still have a deep valley, but this part of the landscape is now slightly disordered, and the whole thing actually falls downward with a velocity which scales 1 over the system size. Then the shaded part, it is called a finite current with phase separation. This is how a configuration looks. There is still a valley, but it is much shallow, and the H and L particles are still completely phase separated, and this whole thing is now moving downward with a finite velocity. And then on this line, B is equal to minus B primed line. This is a special line. You see that if you put B is equal to minus B primed, that means that the landscape fluctuations are completely insensitive to whether you have an H particle or L particle. In another way of saying this is the particles do not affect the dynamics of the landscape at all. So that is this FDPO phase, where the landscape is completely disordered and H and L particles show a weak clustering tendency, but that clustering is not complete as in the other phases. Finally, I have the disordered phase. This is the dotted part of the phase diagram where everything is disordered, and I'll mainly focus on that. Achha, by the way, how much time do I have?
I guess we have been asking you a lot of questions. Maybe Rishi could answer.
I think we have at least 15 minutes because we started 5 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. Because I still have not started talking about the dynamics in the disordered phase. Okay. So now in the disordered phase, the particle and the landscape, they do not show any long. Yes. Is there a question?
I have a question. So could you go back to the previous? Yeah. In the part B, you said that is velocity with which particles are, I mean, it scales with 1 over L, something like that.
Yeah. Right.
So is it not the case with A and in the figure A?
No, in the figure A, the velocity actually scales exponentially. With the system size, e to the minus L. This one. Okay. Here it is 1 over L. Here it is finite. So in the disordered phase, as I have shown, that there is no long-range order. However, there are short-range correlations present. And I do not know the nature of these short-range correlations. So to see how strongly they affect how strong these correlations are, I look at these following quantities. Here I have defined two variables, eta I, that tells you the site occupancy, whether it is an H or L particle, and sigma I tells you the bond orientation, whether it is plus or minus 45 degree. So these are both are binary variables. And here I have measured four types of correlation, site, between the site and the next bond, site and the previous bond, and bond. So these four correlations, I have shown the heat map in the disordered phase. So there are two things that you should notice here. One is that the particle-particle correlations are strongest. Look at this scale. Okay, the particle-particle correlations are strongest, which means if I want to use some mean field-like approximation, then this is the correlation that I should be worried about most. Second point is, all the correlations become weak towards the bottom left corner of the phase diagram. Actually, this corner point, where both B and B primed are minus half, this is a special point. In this point, actually, it can be shown exactly that the system satisfies a product measure. This means that at this particular point, all the correlations factorize in the system. And around this point, actually, all the correlations become weak. So therefore, my strategy is like this, that if I want to use mean field theory or some such assumption, I should stay in this region of the phase diagram where the correlations are already weak. That this is the best shot that my approximation will work. So here I have written down the expression for particle current and the tilt current. These are the two conserved variables, remember, the particle density and the field density. So here, I think these are self-explanatory. For example, this current expression involves these three-point correlations. Here, this is H particle followed by a downslope bond followed by an L. If there is a local configuration like this, then the H will move rightward with a rate d plus a. Similarly, all these terms can be explained. And if, for example, here there is an upslope, downslope, and an H in between. If there is a local configuration like this, then upslope will move rightward with a rate e plus b. Problem is, this is a formal expression for current, but I do not know what is the form of these three-point correlators. So my first guess will be, okay, let me do the simplest possible thing. Let me do a mean field theory. I completely neglect all the correlations in the system and just write them as the product of 3 1-point correlations. So I just replace it like density of H particle, density of downslope bonds, density of L particle, product of that. So if I do that, then this is the expression for J rho and J m that I get from mean field theory. I can do something better than that. I can say that no, I'm going to not neglect all the correlation. I will retain correlation between a site and the next bond, let's say, and I will factorize the rest. So therefore, these three-point objects, I can now factorize them like this, that I will retain the correlation between H and this downslope. This object I don't touch, but instead of L, I just write 1 minus rho. Similarly here, I retain the H and the downslope, this part, and instead of this upslope, I just write M. And then I write down the time evolution equation for these two-point correlations. Of course, this time evolution equation will not close. That is, it will involve higher order correlations. And I'm going to factorize that also. I'm not going to retain anything beyond a two-point correlation, site and the next bond. And then, I can solve for these two-point correlations and write down an expression, approximate expression for current. I can do something even more, I can improve it even further. I can retain the full three-point correlations. All the three-point correlations which are present in the expression for current, I say I retain all the three-point correlations like this or this, and I'm going to factorize all the other correlations. So by doing either of these methods, I can write down an approximate expression for J rho and J m. And from there, I can calculate the G matrix, the mode coupling matrix, and the find out the conditions for various different universality classes. One good thing is our final conclusions are not so sensitive upon which approximation we are using. Because you see, whether I am interested in which dynamical universality class do I have. And that universality class depends on whether certain elements of the mode coupling matrices are zero or non-zero, as I have argued before. Actual values of these matrix elements, that do not matter. These actual values actually depend on which approximation scheme I am using. But that doesn't affect my conclusions on which particular dynamical, which particular universality class I have. So which is a good thing. So then I will demonstrate how finite size effects can play an extremely important role in this type of work. So first I will demonstrate it for this case where b prime are minus half, which is the product measure point, where I actually know that all correlations factorize and my mean field theory becomes exact. So I have an exact expression for current. And so there, for some particular value of rho and m, let us say I have these values of the self-coupling. Not let us say, I mean, this is actually what happens if you choose rho and m. You can show that the both the self-coupling are non-vanishing for mode 1 and mode 2, and their value is minus 0.6. I will show you that this case, I encounter a very strong finite size effect. So here is my data, and since I don't have much time, I will just quickly go over this. So I have chosen system size 500, 4000, and 16000, and I have plotted the dynamical structure function for different values of time and tried the scaling collapse. And as you can see, I expect a KPZ scaling here. So one over Z is 2/3, that is 0.67. And even when my system size is as large as 16,000, I still get 0.65. And this was even worse when I was 500 or 4,000. And this green line actually shows the Prokofiev-Kohn scaling function. But you see the master curve does not match with the scaling function that is expected. So the finite size effects are very strong here. On the other hand, choose some other value where, let's say, one self-coupling coefficient is very large. I mean, much larger, let's say around minus 0.9. Then I see my finite size effects are much weaker. Even at size 1000, I get a pretty good agreement with KPZ scaling. And at 4000, I get a very good agreement, as good as it gets. So now what is the reason for this? Why finite size corrections are stronger for smaller self-coupling? So to understand that, I will again write down, look at this scaling function. And here you see, if both Z alpha and Z beta are 3/2, let me see how these other functions, these subleading corrections, how do they vanish with K? So this one is 2 minus 3/2, so it vanishes as root K. This one is 1 plus 2/3 minus 3/2, which is K⁄1/6, which is a slow convergence. Now, for a particular system size that I am doing my simulation in, system size is n, and the slowest value of k that is possible is 2 pi over n. So now you see how finite size corrections become very, very important. This one goes to zero as slow as n⁻⁶, which is very, very slow. So therefore, unless n is very large, I am always going to see the effect of these terms, and that is going to overshadow my observation of the scaling collapse. Except if q alpha alpha already has a large magnitude. If the value of q alpha alpha is already pretty large, then what happens that this term, which is supposed to dominate, is already large. So now I have some advantage. I may not need that big n, that big system size, in order to overcome the effect of this term and see a clean KPZ scaling. Okay. So the
Shakuntala, could you not measure some slightly different observable that sort of filters out the n⁻⁶ contributor, like which has in the, can you not measure a slightly different observable that doesn't have, quote unquote, an overlap with that node that is going to cause the n⁻⁶? Can you not measure something else?
So here what I am measuring is something that is pretty defined. I am interested in the dynamical structure function. You are asking if there could be some other quantity that I could measure which shows the same universality class, but it doesn't have this thing.
You filter that out by measuring something else.
Yeah, I understand. I don't know this, because this scaling solution, everything that I have is only for this dynamical structure function. I know that if I measure cross correlation between the modes, then I don't get anything, because the modes are traveling with different speed and ballistically their overlap goes to zero. But you are asking if there is some other quantity that measure. I don't know that actually. I have only measured this one. Okay. And there I have this strong finite size effects to worry about. Yeah. Okay. So the point that I was making is how finite size effects can be very strong. And just to give you an order of magnitude, in our model, the mode coupling matrices, their elements cannot be unbounded. Okay. So the maximum value that is possible within our parameter regime, that is actually 2. And from our experience, we have seen that if the value is larger than 0.9, then it is considered to be a large value. You should have a very good scaling. If the value is of the order of 0.5 or larger than that, you still have a reasonable chance of seeing it numerically. But if it falls below 0.3 or 0.4, then the chances are very slim that you are, because then you will expect that the finite size corrections will mask everything. And imagine all these things I have said for the product measured point, where I do have the exact expression for current. Now I am going to use this theory in the other part of the disordered phase, where I don't even have an exact expression for current. Therefore, I have to rely more strongly on numerics. And then it is extremely crucial that I pay very close attention to this finite size effect. So here, this is one part where we were successful. We could see KPZ and 5/3 Levy modes in our system. And for in order to see KPZ and 5/3 Levy, before I show you the results, let me first give you an idea of how what are the finite size corrections here. For the KPZ mode, the diffusive term goes as root k. The cross-coupling term, because the other mode has exponent 5/3, it goes as slow as k to the 1 over 10. So you imagine how slow it is. There is absolutely no hope of seeing this unless you start with a very, very strong self-coupling. For the 5/3 Levy scaling, self-coupling term ought to vanish, and the diffusive term vanishes as k to the 1/3, which is also pretty small, pretty slow. So here are the condition to observe the KPZ 5/3 Levy pair. For the mode alpha, I should have non-vanishing self-coupling. For the mode beta, I should have vanishing self-coupling and non-vanishing cross-coupling. So here I have shown the heat map of these G matrix elements for a particular point in the disordered phase, where which is close to this product measure point, where I expect the spatial correlations to be weak. So you see here that if I stay around this part or this part, then this self-coupling is large, the other self-coupling is small, and this cross-coupling is also, the cross-coupling terms are also reasonably large. So this is my best shot to choose rho and m from these regions in order to see the KPZ and 5/3 Levy modes. So indeed, this is what I find. And how long do I have now? 5 minutes or slightly more than that?
I guess you can, if I could say, Rishi, you can take more than 5 minutes.
More than 5 minutes, okay. Yeah. Okay, just tell me when you want me to stop, okay? So, so here, just to demonstrate the finite size effects, here you see, if I choose rho and m like this, then the self-coupling coefficient is large for the mode 2. The self-coupling coefficient for mode 1 is small. I can almost take it to be 0. And the cross-coupling coefficient is not too large, but it's okay, 0.4. So actually, I do find good agreement with 5/3 Levy and KPZ scaling in this case. So, and also the scaling function matches pretty well with 5/3 Levy stable distribution and KPZ scaling function. Choose another point where the self-coupling is okay, not so small, 0.5. The other self-coupling is very small, but the cross-coupling is now becoming small. It is of the order of 0.1, 0.13. Now I will expect that KPZ scaling should be good, but 5/3 Levy should not be good. And indeed, that's what I find. KPZ scaling is not so bad, not terribly good, but it's still okay, acceptable. But 5/3 Levy scaling is now totally gone. Instead, I am just observing a diffusive scaling. Not only the dynamical exponent is 2 here, the scaling function also matches with the Gaussian. What is happening here is because the diffusive term, remember, it goes as k to the 1/3. And because the cross-coupling term is small, the diffusive term just completely overshadows it, and I'm numerically observing the diffusive term. There is one puzzle that we have encountered here. That is this case when both rho and m are large. Here, the parameter values are such that I expect good KPZ and good 5/3 Levy. But I do not find that. Sorry. I don't know if you can see the full slide. It is full screen, but I am not able to see it anyway. So here, both KPZ and 5/3 Levy observations are pretty poor. And 5/3 Levy is not present at all. And for KPZ also, I get an exponent around 0.64. We don't understand what is happening here. But one thing we have observed, that whenever both rho and m are large or small simultaneously, that both are close to one or close to zero, we find that our NLFH predictions are not holding up well. So we don't know why it is so. Another case that we have found is modified Cartesian diffusive modes. Here, I will just make this point quickly. Here we have, for modified Cartesian diffusive mode, the condition is for the mode beta, which is diffusive, there should be no coupling at all. For the mode alpha, which is modified KP, there should be non-vanishing self-coupling and cross-coupling both. So here, this is one such point where for the mode 1, I have 1.8 and 0.6, pretty large values. And for mode 2, both the values are close to 0. So we do find a good collapse with agreement with KPZ and diffusive. There is one strange thing, that is the scaling function turns out to be very similar to the usual cone scaling function, which is expected for the usual KPZ scaling. Even for another point in the parameter set, we are observing the same thing. Now, there are two possibilities which we could think of here. One is that in both the cases where we could see these conditions are satisfied, the self-coupling coefficient was much, much larger than the cross-coupling coefficient. So it is possible that in the scaling function, the presence of the cross-coupling term is not felt so strongly. And the system behaves as if there is only the self-coupling term present, and it gives you back the usual Prohofer-Schwann scaling function. But there is also another possibility that so far nobody has been able to exactly calculate a modified KPZ universality class. So it is possible, we cannot rule out this possibility, that maybe it is not so different from the usual KPZ scaling. So we don't know. This is the final last point I wanted to make. That is, the finite size effects mask certain universality classes. For example, golden mean universality class. In order to observe golden mean, the conditions are for both the modes, I should have vanishing self-coupling and non-vanishing cross-coupling. Then the dynamical exponents satisfy this equation, that z alpha is 1 plus 1 over z beta, and z beta is 1 plus 1 over z alpha. And when you solve this recursively, you get the golden mean as a solution. However, this criteria, that vanishing self-coupling and non-vanishing cross-coupling, cannot be simultaneously satisfied in our system. This is what I mean, that remember, wherever you have vanishing self-coupling, in the same region, you also have at least one cross-coupling term which is becoming small. And therefore, finite size effects become large, and you are not able to see golden mean universality class at all. Same thing happens for three-half Levy and diffusive universality class also. The criteria could not be satisfied. I mean, the quantity that you want it to be non-zero tends to take smallish value when the other parameters are small, other parameters are zero. So therefore, finite size effects completely mask that. So this is my conclusion, that we have studied, we have extended the NLFH formalism for the case when exact current density relationship is not known. In fact, for most systems, actually, this relationship is not known. But so far, this work was done only for those cases where this relationship is available. But for many cases, you just have short-range correlations whose form you don't understand. And therefore, it is important to know that what you should do in that case. And our work was the first step in that direction. Finite size effects play a very important role in this case, as I have seen. And in fact, I would say that actually effectively modifies the NLFH prediction. We are saying that it is not enough to have a certain mode coupling coefficient to be non-zero. Its magnitude also needs to be large enough in order that this system size is coming in the numerically accessible range. And also finally, it is good to, and I mean, whatever we said, it was just particularly for our system, and it is good to understand. Have some general understanding for the importance of finite size effects for these new kind of universality classes. So with that, I would like to thank you for your attention.
So,
Okay, yeah, great. Thanks, Chavurta. We can have maybe a few more questions.
Sure.
Yes, so if I could start with, so you showed that, so most of this different scaling behaviors comes from this k tends to zero limit of the structure factor.
Yes.
So I understood the KPZ, but did you, I didn't get where does the Levy comes, like in your...
Okay. Yeah, let me just go to that.
Because here it's, you're making a very strong statement. It's not just the exponent. You're actually, the statement is about that the scaling function is exactly the Levy distribution. Right?
Yeah. So here, when you have this, when you have vanishing self-coupling, the self-coupling term is vanishing. Then you have this Z alpha is 1 plus 1 over Z beta max. So here, depending on different values of Z beta, you can get different, these are the Levy scaling. These are the Levy modes where it is coming. If this mode, for example, if Z beta in this case, when you have two, if Z beta max is let's say 2, then you get 3/2 Levy.
Right.
When Z beta max is 3/2, then you get 5/3 Levy, like that. So and the scaling function is given by this. Okay, this is, no, sorry, this is not the scaling
function. How is that mode?
How?
The mode of form of the scaling function in that case?
Yeah, the scaling function is, okay. For example, here, we have just argued that the diffusive term drops out in this case. So you have this term and this term. And now, when you take, I mean, if you just, put it back in this dynamical structure function, then you get this Levy stable distribution. You can do that calculation.
So it's
remember, the dynamical structure function was it looks like this. In the so here, h alpha, zeta alpha, you put that value, and that gives you this Levy stable distributions, 3/2 or 5/3, depending on what you have. Is it okay? It involves some long calculations that, but it comes from this. You put this H alpha, zeta alpha, you put that K goes to zero limit here, and then you, it comes from there. Because once you have that, you have the dynamical structure function.
So is it, if I understand, so the Z for your systems, could you predict the Z that, or you take the value of Z from numerical observation, and then once the Z is fixed, then of course you get the scaling function.
So I know what Z to expect, because from the, since once I'm able to construct the mode coupling matrix from the, its values, I know which Z to expect. And now I check it against my numerical simulation, because after all, I was, for most part, I have used an approximate expression for current.
That's why you need the mean field limit in order.
I need something. I need something. Mean field or slightly improved version of mean field. I need something to calculate the G matrix elements, and then I can check it against numerical simulations.
Okay. And in order to get, like, if are there examples where systems has correlations and one could still do a coarse graining and get a formula for these currents?
I don't see why not, because these hydrodynamic expansions, I would expect them to remain valid.
Right. So even in the part where your systems is correlated,
I
expect it to be valid, right?
I expect it to be valid. Yeah. If the correlations are short-ranged, I expect them to remain valid.
Right.
Because nowhere in this hydrodynamic expansion, I have used the fact that correlations need to factorize in the formalism.
Precisely. Yes. Yes. Although the because what you are measuring in your numerical simulation are the microscopic correlations, right?
That's right.
And once you do the coarse graining, they might just go to very higher orders in the gradient. And
I don't think so, because it is true. We are doing it like this, but the thing is, the mean field, I would expect the mean field theory should work everywhere, but actually that is not the case.
Macroscopic level.
Even at the macroscopic, I mean, if I just compared the current that I'm measuring, Okay, and compare it with the mean field prediction, at most places it doesn't work very well.
Okay.
But I still, I mean, what actually saves us here is that the exact value may not be so important, because the mode coupling matrix, I mean, it matters whether the elements are zero or non-zero. If they are non-zero, whether they are 1.5 or 1.7 or that is immaterial, so far as the universality class is concerned.
So, is there any more questions? Yeah.
Okay, I guess I'm just going to ask. If there are no other questions, I will maybe stop recording. We can.